All right, well, we're still in the book of Revelation, or we've been doing a study on end time events. And so we are in the book of Revelation, or at least we're looking at some different concepts in the book of Revelation. Last week we finished up a two-part teaching on the seals. And one of the things that I wanted to mention, because I didn't really mention this part of this particular seal, if you'll remember that the fourth horse and the four first seals were actually also known as the four horsemen of the apocalypse. You remember we talked about that? And so the first horse was the white horse, and that was actually the opening of that seal. And remember, it was actually the Lamb that opened the seal, okay? Meaning Jesus. So Jesus is the one that initiates the opening of the seals. And then the first horse that comes forth is the white horse, and it's what we came to the conclusion is that it's the Antichrist. All right, so the first seal that's opened up releases the Antichrist. A crown is given unto him. He's given power in order to move upon the earth. Then the next horse is a red horse, and it's the horse of war. It's got a sword. The third horse after that is a black horse. It's a horse of famine. And one of the things we talked about is that a natural occurrence that takes place after war is famine. And then the fourth horse, the Word of God says in the King James Version that it's a pale horse, but in the Greek language, the word is actually chloros, which is where we get the word chlorine, which means green. So, and you know what? One of the things that I told you in one of the little slides I had was I had what's called a pan-Arab flag that represents the Muslim revolt. It's basically the Muslim revolt flag, and it had all four of those colors in there. It had black, red, white, and green. And so And I always do this. Now, whenever I say these things and I can't prove anything because it's something that I feel like the Holy Spirit put on my heart, but if I don't have any evidence at all, I don't usually just say stuff. But at the same time, whenever I'm giving you my opinion, then I always let you know that I'm giving you my opinion, okay? Because the scripture isn't saying that for sure. It just tells us that there's these four horsemen and what their colors were. And on that last one, what I said was, wouldn't it be an interesting thought that if the four horsemen represented the Antichrist and then also represented how he would use Islam in the end days in order to accomplish both sword and famine and peril and causing death to all of these people. Now, one of the things that we didn't point out was that it says right here, Revelation 6:7, and when he had opened the fourth seal, that's the pale horse, which is the really green chloros, and his name that sat on him was death and hell, was death, and hell followed with him, and power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beasts of the earth. And I just did a little bit of math. I Googled, and you know, I was doing it while Isabella was driving, and you could see how fast babies were being born as this little clock kept moving, but I just rounded it off. I just put 7.3 billion. And then I divided that by a fourth, and what I came up with was 1.7 billion. And so basically a fourth, if you know, the end happened next week, basically you're looking at when the fourth seal is opened up, that's how many people are dying. And I just wanted to make a point, because last week and the week before, I also pointed out that some people feel as though the possibility, could the seals have been opened? Do you remember that? I showed you that picture of Obama, and he was in Broncos Stadium in Vesco Field, and they had that white stallion up on top, and that some people had alluded to the fact that maybe this was representative of the first seal being opened, because some people think Obama's the Antichrist and different things like that. I'm just going to be honest with you. I think he's an Antichrist. I mean, the Word of God says that there will be many Antichrists and that there's a spirit of Antichrist. Listen, I'm not here to pick a political persuasion, because I ain't. To be honest with you, if you leave it up to me, I don't really want to vote for any of them anymore. Amen. And let me tell you why. Now, I'm not telling you don't vote. Oh, Lord, we got a preacher telling people not to vote. No, that's not what I said. I didn't say that. But what I am going to tell you is, and I don't mean to go off on it again, but I'm going to. Whenever you have a 9-part Supreme Court and they tell you that you're supposed to vote, now, you may not even think politically like I do. Okay, and that's fine. Don't get mad at me. Oh, he's talking politics. No, I'm not. I'm telling you. I've changed my views. I'm a Jesus freak is what I am. I love Jesus. Amen. And I know what the Word of God's telling me. And if you're aborting millions of babies every year, we got Houston, we got a problem. That's, listen to me. this is what the word of the Lord said to Jeremiah. Before I formed thee in the womb, I knew thee. God had a plan for Jeremiah's life before he was ever formed in the womb. And so it doesn't really matter what we think, and we can sit here and have an argument if that's what we choose to do. But the fact of the matter is that killing unborn babies is not of God.
Amen.
And we can get into it a whole lot more than that. All right. But anyway, nevertheless, what I'm trying to say is that there's always been political parties that said that they believed in a certain way. And it seems like people can relate to one particular party or another. Is that right? I mean, is that not what people typically do? If you're more tend to go more liberal-minded, you might vote for a Democrat. If you believe in more conservatism, then you might go towards a Republican. Well, so that's what they used to tell me when I first got into politics. They said, what you need to do is you need to vote conservative because they'll put conservatives on the Supreme Court. And then the next thing you know, you vote for conservatives and they appoint conservatives on the Supreme Court and they got them 5-4. But all of a sudden, whenever the Obamacare thing comes, it's 5-4 in favor of Obamacare. But the problem is that it takes one of the conservatives to vote for it. And then whenever the whole gay marriage thing happened, again, split 5-4. And so what I'm trying to say is that they're sitting here telling us that they're appointing conservatives. All I'm asking them to do is to do what they say that they're going to do. If the Democrats have it, fine. But what I'm trying to get at is that I don't think that you can trust people anymore. You know, and you may not agree with me, but I'm going to say it anyway. Do you think that the government couldn't be corrupt? Do you think that leaders couldn't be corrupt? Do you think, whenever we talked about Revelation 17 a long time ago, and we talked about the seven-headed beast, and that it represented the kings of the earth, and it represented kingdoms, do you think there's a possibility that the enemy of your soul and the enemy of this world could have kingdoms and powerful men in his clutches and moving and manipulating them? I know that the big buzzword now is Illuminati, but what I'm trying to say is that's the occult. This stuff's been here since the Garden Incident. If you believe the Bible, I'm just letting you know this stuff's been here since the Garden Incident and since the Tower of Babel. And so all I'm trying to say is that the governments, you can't trust them. All right. And so, but here we are with a fourth or a fourth of these people dying, 1.7 billion. And I got off on a rabbit trail because I was talking about Obama, and I'm trying to make a point that the seals, and when the seals are opened, and we've gotten this far, we're talking 1.7 billion people dead. That's a lot of people. Yeah, I mean, I don't remember how many died in that tsunami, but we were going on, and it was a lot of people in that earthquake in Haiti, but it wasn't nothing like this. You understand what I'm getting at? And so I don't think that we're there. It's pretty obvious to me that the seals at this point in time haven't been opened. Now, I can't tell you what's going to happen next week. Okay, I don't know what's going to happen next week and the week after. But the point is this, is that there's a large death ratio going on here. Now, one of the things that I pointed out last time is that when we got to the end of seal number 5 and then we transitioned to seal number 6, it seemed as though, to me anyway, that there was a little bit of a change taking place. And what I meant by that was that the Antichrist was released, and then from there he began to, the next thing you know, we have war and we have famine, and associated with that is all of this death. And one of the things that I pointed out was that that's easy enough for a man who is in control to accomplish all of those things, right? So ultimately, yes, the Lamb opened up the seal, but actually the Antichrist could very well be in control of wars and famines and even releasing pestilences. You think that men, as a matter of fact, it's pretty well known that viruses are created in laboratories all over the world. I mean, people know that, and all it takes is for people to release that kind of thing. All I'm trying to say is that those things are easily done by human beings. But whenever we made a transition from seal number 5 to seal number 6, it was different. And what was different was, it says right here in Revelation 6:9, well, this is actually seal number 5, and the reason that I'm reading this again is because we're going to get into another passage of scripture a little later on that I want to connect back to this. So let's go back to seal number 5. We talked a little bit about seal 4, which is the pale or green horse. And then here's seal number 5. When he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain. As a matter of fact, let's go to the Bible right there. Revelation chapter 6, if you have your Bible. Revelation chapter 6, verse 9. It says, "And when he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held." So they gave their lives were given for the testimony of Jesus. Amen. "And they cried with a loud voice, saying, 'How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth?' And white robes were given unto every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest for a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled." So they're wanting to know when their blood's going to be avenged. They gave their life for the cause of Jesus Christ. Amen. And they're wanting to know. But the picture is that they're under an altar. I had a picture whenever we taught this one last week of the brazen altar, which is the Old Testament altar where the animal sacrifices were offered up, which is an Old Testament type of the cross. Amen. And so we never really can forget that. As a matter of fact, it's important that you realize that the reason that they're clothed in white robes is for one reason and one reason only. Jesus told the church of Laodicea in chapter 3, he said, I'm paraphrasing, but he said, "I urge you to get from me white garment." Amen. White robes. Clothe yourself in white robes. And what the white robe or garment represents is the righteousness of Christ. We teach that a lot in this church, amen. But you got to understand, righteousness of God is not your works and your performance, amen. The righteousness of God is a person. His name is Jesus. And whenever you put your faith in him, have you put your faith in Jesus? That's a good question to ask you. Have you put your faith in Jesus? I'm not talking about your intellect. I'm not talking about how, you know, "Oh yeah, my mama told me when I was a little boy that Jesus died on the cross for me. And I believe that there was a man, 33-year-old Jew, he died on two pieces of wood outside a city called Jerusalem. I believe that." That's not what I'm talking about. I want to know, did you give your heart to him? Did you lay your heart out before him and say, "Lord, I understand I'm a sinner and I need you. And I believe you died on the cross to set me free. Lord, please come into my heart." Amen. Amen. I see some of you shaking your head. You're like, "Yeah, man, I invited Jesus into my heart." Praise God. If you did, I got good news. You may not be able to see it, but you're wearing a white robe right now. Hallelujah. You've been clothed with a garment. And the garment is the righteousness of Christ. God, the Word of God says that he can find no one greater to swear by. Therefore, he swore by himself. God became man, he lived as man, he died as man. He made right what the first Adam made wrong. And when you took your faith and you put it in what Jesus did, God says, "Yes, now I see you as righteous, not because you did all the right stuff, but because you took your faith and you placed it in Christ." That's what it says right here. They were given white robes, not because they died. Not even because of the fact that, you would think that if somebody's going to die, because, I mean, the truth is, it's not just because they died, because they got Muslims that die all the time. And they're dying for a lie. Yeah. Well, how can you say that, preacher? Because there's only one God.
Amen.
I mean, I've talked to Muslims left and right. And I mean, I'm not as animated as when I'm talking to you right now, but whenever I talk to them, I'm like, whenever they try to convince me, I'm like, "Hold on a second, time out." And I do this to the Jehovah's Witnesses, I do this to the Mormons, I do this to anybody I'm talking to. Maybe you can use it, maybe you can't. Time out, hold on a second, one of us is wrong. I mean, let's cut through the chase. Listen, I mean, I'm not trying to be mean or anything. I'm not trying to get you mad at me. I'm not trying to step on your toes. I'm not trying to poke my finger in your eyeball. But what I will say is this, one of us is wrong. We can't both be right. You can't say Jesus was a good man and a prophet, but then at the same time he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me." He can't be a liar and a good prophet at the same time. You can't say that you can get through Allah in another way and Jesus says, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life." No, there's not many ways. There's one way. And the problem that we're going to run into, and the reason that these martyrs that are under the altar right here have died for the faith is because there's coming a time when that stuff ain't going to be put up with anymore. I'm telling you that right now. I've said it before, but I'll say it again. There's coming a time when the real church is going to have to stand up and they're going to have to suffer some persecution, and it's not going to be that cool to be a Christian anymore. And when that time comes, persecution's on the horizon. And we're going to need the grace of God to give us strength, amen, to face the onslaught of the enemy and to face with the world system that's coming against it, and it's coming against it right now. I hope you can see that. I hope you can see that in the big churches that are on TV, and whenever they ask people like, well, I'm just going to tell you, Joel Osteen, and they ask all these other people like that on Larry King Live and everybody else, and you know, people don't like it when you call that kind of stuff out, but it's like, hold on a second, they asked the man straight up if, you know, he don't want to judge anything. What? Nobody asked you to be the judge. Just tell them what the Word of God says, Joel. That's all you got to do. Just tell them what the Word of God says. The Word of God says this. Last week, somebody pointed out that I picked on the homosexual a little bit, and maybe I softened it up when I got to fornicators. Guess what? It's all in the same boat with the Lord. You can't be a fornicator and an adulterer and think you're better off than a homosexual. It doesn't work that way. Lord, help us. Change us. Change our hearts. Amen? That's what the Word of God says. Don't shrink back from it. Hallelujah. Tell the truth. Anyway, these martyrs have given their life for the cause of Jesus Christ. They believed in Christ. They believed in it to the point where they laid down their life. It's what it says in another chapter in Revelation. It says that they overcame him, talking about the enemy, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they loved not their own lives even unto death. And so these, they gave their life, and they're under the altar. And white robes were given to them. I said all that because I hope that you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And I hope that you also are clothed in the garment of righteousness. And this is the sixth seal. It says, and when he opened the sixth seal, lo, there was a great earthquake. And the sun became black as sackcloth of hair. And the moon became as blood. And the stars of heaven fell unto the earth. Now, what I want you to know is this. Is that this is where I saw a transition taking place from the tribulation to wrath. You understand what I'm trying to say? Great tribulation was when the seal was first opened up. The first seal was opened up. The white horse came forth. Is considered the beginning of the great tribulation. And whenever that first rider came forth, it was the Antichrist. But then the next thing you know, we got war and we have famine and we have death. And all of those things, mankind in unity against God can cause those things to happen. Does that make sense? But mankind can't cause this to happen. I know I said it last week, but I'm going to say it again. The earthquake, the sun became black as sackcloth of hair. The moon became as blood. The stars of the heaven, it says, fell unto the earth. Mankind can't accomplish that. So what I'm trying to show you is that there's a delineation, at least in my eyes, between tribulation and then wrath. This is wrath. This is the wrath of God. As a matter of fact, it goes on to say right here, if we keep on reading in Revelation chapter 6, starting in verse 12, we'll just read this again. I beheld when he opened the sixth seal, lo, there was a great earthquake. The sun became black as sackcloth of hair. The moon became as blood. The stars of heaven fell unto the earth. Even as a fig tree casts her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man hid themselves in the dens, and in the rocks, and of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sits on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? I'm just trying to make a point. I know I'm being redundant, but there's a transitioning here between tribulation and wrath. And I just want to make sure that you can see that. Okay? And so here's the what I wanted to turn to Matthew chapter 24. And I want to just kind of read through this chapter. And I want to show you some things. And I want to kind of connect it to this passage in Revelation. So what we talked about before was a pre-tribulation rapture, right? The church, age, and then the rapture takes place, and then the tribulation starts, a seven-year period of great tribulation. And once again, I've tried to make it very clear as I've taught this, I'm not taking a position. Amen? I'm just trying to go to the scriptures and I'm trying to show you some things that the Lord showed me. And then I just want you to apply it and see what you think about it. That's all I'm trying to say. I think we've been hemmed into a box for so long that if you dare transgress a pre-tribulation rapture, all of a sudden you're shunned by anybody. I'm not trying to go one way or the other. I'm just trying to show you some things in the scripture. And so there's this seven-year tribulation that takes place after the rapture. But what I'm trying to say is that the first five seals, if you will, really and truly, it was the first four seals of the four horsemen. And then we're told about the five seals, which were martyrs underneath the altar, which likely died at the initiation of these four seals. And now they're under the altar. And then we move into seal number six. And so what we see is that from here to here is a time of great tribulation. Does that make sense? But then right here, we're entering into the wrath of the Lamb. And that's whenever the stars start falling from the sky like from a fig tree, when the sun becomes black, when the moon becomes red like blood. And so I guess what I'm trying to say is that I'm seeing a passage of scripture here that looks as though to me it kind of looks like a rapture too. And it's after the tribulation has started. And at the same time, it's in the interim while the wrath is taking place. I'm not telling you with certainty that that's what it is, but I'm telling you, I'm not going to ask you to do that, but as you read the Bible for yourself, and as you start studying these things, sometimes it's not quite as clear as what everybody was telling you. And I'm not trying to cause any confusion. I'm just telling you, this is what I see. This is what I'm going to try to point out to you and try to teach you. And then you kind of look at it. And then the good news is that if we got a pre-tribulation, you didn't have to worry about the crazy preacher. But if things start happening, and let me just back up one more second. Let me say this again. You got to be careful that you over-explain yourself whenever you do something a little bit different, because people start walking around town calling you a heretic. All right. And what I'm trying to tell you is this: even if we believe in a pre-tribulation rapture, do we think, and I know I've said this many times, but let me say it one more time. Do we think that just because we live in America, we may not see some what we consider great tribulation before the rapture takes place, even if it's a pre-tribulation rapture? We think that just because we're Americans, that bad things can't happen to us? Come on, somebody. I mean, you've seen things happening on American soil that have never happened before.
Amen.
If you've done any research on your own about any of the things that have happened since 2001, your brain should be a little bit boggled by now, and you should be aware of the fact that something ain't right.
Amen.
Amen? Well, so that's my point I'm trying to make, is that we may have to endure. And I think that if anybody that's going to come to this church, even if you're just visiting every now and then, I haven't done my job if I haven't prepared you to believe and to understand that there may come a day when you got to know Jesus well enough to where you're going to have to make a decision like some of these people that we see their souls up under that altar. Now, that won't necessarily build a church with big numbers, but it'll prepare a person's heart, amen, to hold on to Jesus and to get to know him, amen, and to study the scriptures to find that to rightly divide the scriptures. Amen. To be a workman and to be able to hold on to the Lord even in the midst of the most worst of circumstances.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but that's what I want to do. I don't want to live for the Lord and at the end lose my soul.
Amen.
So in this passage of scripture in Matthew chapter 24, it says that Jesus was on the Mount of Olives. That's what it says in verse 3. As he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, "Tell us, when shall these things be?" So Matthew 24, verse 3, Jesus is on the Mount of Olives with his disciples. And I put this picture up here because I just Googled a picture. What would have it looked like when Jesus was on the Mount of Olives looking at the temple? Now, this isn't the temple right here. Okay, if you know anything about pictures and temples and whatnot, this is the dome of the mosque. This is the Muslim mosque that was built during the Ottoman Empire after the temple was destroyed during the time frame of the Crusaders. And they call it the Dome of the Rock. They hurried up and built this thing whenever they took over Jerusalem, and it's been standing there ever since. And this is the big contention. There's a long story behind that. We've taught it before. We don't have time to get into it. But what they would have been looking at was Herod's temple. And it was a finished product of the temple that Nehemiah and them had built. And it was one of the seven wonders of the world. And so they would have been looking at Herod's temple And now this is what we're looking at. That's what's standing there today. All right. And so it says right here in verse 4, and Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. He's already warning you that you're going to be deceived. He's telling his disciples. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Now, you know, let me just say this. I heard this one preacher one time named Alberto Rivera. He was a Jesuit priest that defected from the Jesuit priesthood. And the most amazing testimony. And he preached a message one time, and you could barely understand him because he spoke in such a deep Hispanic accent. But I'm telling you, he pounded the papacy. He preached and he said many antichrists. He said that there would be many Christs and that they were he said, let me tell you something. He said the way that you have to be saved in Catholicism, whether they realize it or not, is by the taking of that Eucharist. And he said that there would be people living in villages. And the fact of the matter is that nobody would ever be able to go bring them communion until for several months. And so they were just on their own. And he preached that message, and he came against Catholicism, and this was just one example. Because basically the word vicar, which is where the word pope, the concept of the pope comes from, literally means Christ on earth. That's why people are going over there and kissing his finger. Exactly. And kissing the ring on his hand. Yeah. And calling him all these other wonderful names. Yeah. And the fact of the matter is that that's just one example of many Christs. Mm-hmm. Antichrist, if you will. And so the word Christ, once again, I know that I'm redundant with this, but it means the anointed one. And we understand Jesus to be the answer of what all the Old Testament prophets said, that the anointed one was coming. The Messiah is in the Hebrew. And so, but there's other people. The Jews didn't believe that he was the one. Now there's Jews that are getting saved that believe he was the one, but the Jewish people as a whole rejected him. And the Muslims are waiting for one to come back. And the occult is waiting. And all that stuff's going to be mixed up whenever this happens. I'm telling you. All right. And so it says right here, and you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. Now, to me, when I read that passage of scripture, let me just say this about Matthew 24. One of the things that I noticed is that there's chronologically, there seems to be movement back and forth. Like it's not all seemingly happening in chronological order. And the reason that I say that is because, number one, it says, he talks about the temple right there, actually in verse 2. If you go back up to verse 2, whenever they asked him about the temple, Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. So just imagine you're sitting on the side of the mountain with Jesus, and you're looking at Herod's temple instead of this dome of the mosque. And his disciples ask him they wanted to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said, you see that? There's going to be a day whenever one stone will not be left unturned. And that was fulfilled in AD 70. That's why they were able to build this building, because in AD 70, a general named Titus of Rome destroyed the temple that was standing there, and basically with a team of horses, kind of like what I guess a modern day leveler would do with a tractor, and a team of horses had like some kind of an I-beam or some kind of big old piece of wood or something, and leveled it all out. Not one stone was left unturned. But that happened in AD 70. And then much of what Jesus is talking about is going to take place in the future. And so it can be taking places in the future at different times. Sometimes, you know, the question is he talking about the rapture or is he talking about the second coming? You understand there's a difference between the two, right? Some people probably know that well, and some people maybe don't. That, you know, the rapture is one time, and let's just talk about a pre-tribulation rapture. That happens here, the rapture. But then we're talking about a 7-year tribulation. At the end of the 7 years, Jesus comes back. Jesus comes back on a white horse is what the Word of God says. Amen? And it says that in Zechariah chapter 12. So there's the rapture and then there's the second coming. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that it seems as though in Matthew 24 that there's a movement chronologically and it could be going back and forth. But nevertheless, this passage right here to me in verse 6 sounds like it could have had something to do with the seals. Do you not see that? You shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled, for all these things must happen, but the end is not yet. See, well, I thought that this was the end. Yeah, the end's not yet. Theoretically, you could be saying this is the first half of the tribulation, and we still got at least another 4 years to go before the end, whenever I come back. Amen? That is what I'm trying to say. It could be. For nation shall rise against nation, wars, kingdom against kingdom, wars, famines, black horse, pestilences, earthquakes. That's what it said whenever seal number 6 was opened, that there was a huge earthquake. All these things are the beginning of sorrows. And again, these are things that could have just been happening throughout the ages, right? I mean, it's a possibility. And so then it says in verse 10, and then shall many be offended. Now that word offended literally means to trip up and to apostatize. Well, so that means to, you literally... Some people don't like to hear this, but you can turn your back on the faith. You can do it. The whole book of Hebrews was written to people who did that. The word in the Greek here is scandalizo, and it means to be scandalized. And people can, because of an offense, because of sin, it hardens their heart. And the next thing you know, they don't even realize it, but they've turned and they've apostatized from the faith. And it says that they will betray one another and that they will hate one another. And many false prophets will rise and deceive many. And we know that there's been false prophets throughout the ages. Because of iniquity shall abound the love of because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Now, it's important for us to understand that there's going to be people getting saved in the midst of the Great Tribulation. Some people have said that the Holy Spirit would be completely taken off the earth. That's not possible. It's not possible for people to get saved on earth if the Holy Spirit is not dealing with the heart of man. All right. At the same time, the way where they get that scripture, and we studied it in detail, but it talked about it in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. About the man of sin and the fact that he hasn't been revealed yet. I don't know if y'all remember that, but that's talking about the Antichrist, and we taught that. And the fact that the man of sin has not been revealed yet. And somebody asked me a question a while back, well, why do you think that it hasn't happened? Well, the Holy Spirit is restraining it. The plan of God, the work of God, is preventing that from happening. And so the Holy Spirit is withholding and restraining from preventing the Antichrist's plan to just come forward. And some people would tell you that actually is talking about the church right there. And that once the church is raptured, then the Antichrist comes forward, okay? Either way, the Holy Spirit's moving and operating in the midst of the church. But nevertheless, it says right here, it says in verse 15, when you therefore see the abomination of desolation spoken by Daniel the prophet stand in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand. Now, let me just take a second with that. I know that this is a lot of wordy information, but does anybody, if you know what the abomination of desolation is, then you've studied the Bible a lot. But let me just tell you that the abomination that causes desolation was something that the prophet Daniel prophesied. And what it talked about, and I know I've talked to y'all about this before, but we have new people, is that In the time frame of the Grecian Empire, when Alexander the Great died, there was a general who took over Jerusalem, and he put a pig on the altar, and that was considered the abomination that causes desolation. So Daniel prophesied it hundreds of years before it happened. Then it happened, okay? And when it happened, he also, the same guy, Antiochus Epiphanes, made them quit worshiping the God that they served. So you would think to most Jews, that was fulfilled at that time. You understand? Because this guy Antiochus Epiphanes took a pig and he put it on the altar. That's an unclean animal. You can't do that. And he did it on purpose to because he knew what the Jewish people. It may not be a big thing to you to eat a pork chop, but you put a pig on the altar and you desecrate the altar. That's a huge thing to these Jewish people. You understand? And so you would think from that time frame, and even if you're a Jew still today looking backwards, that that's what Daniel was talking about when he prophesied and it happened a couple hundred years later. This is the abomination that causes desolation. The guy put a pig on the altar. But Jesus comes back 1,000 years later, or at least 600 years later, and he says, when you therefore see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, then you need to be awakened. So, Jesus just stepped back on the scene and he told us, no, that wasn't the ultimate fulfillment. Yeah, Antiochus Epiphanes, he threw a pig on the altar, and yes, it desolated the altar and it made everything unclean, but that wasn't the fulfillment of what Daniel was talking about. What he was talking about was this right here, that this Antichrist, according to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, is going to exalt himself in the very temple of God. So that means this thing has to come down and a temple has to be rebuilt. And that can happen fast. I don't know if you've seen what they do with construction these days, but nevertheless, what I want you to know is that that's the abomination that causes desolation. And so what Jesus is saying is, when you see this man stand up in the temple and exalt himself as God, now something's happened. You're in the midst of it, and we would call that a mid-trib sign or a mid-trib happening, because in the beginning of the tribulation is whenever there's a covenant that's signed according to Daniel 7, and it says in the middle of the tribulation the covenant is broken. And so once he breaks that covenant, it says that he's going to exalt himself. He's going to exalt himself as God, to be worshiped as God. And so Jesus is telling us about that right here. And he goes on to tell them in verse 16, then let them which be in Judea, when you see this, and you're in basically in Judea is the southern part where Jerusalem is, then you need to flee to the mountains. Let him who is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house, neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes. And woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days. But pray that your flight be not in the winter, for then shall be great tribulation, such as what was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. So I just want you to see this. Now we're just talking. The word elect is eklektos in the Greek, and I've talked to you about this word before, but this word is a preposition in the Greek, and it means out, and this means chosen. And so what is it basically what the word means? It means chosen out, and it's a similar word to the word church in the Greek, which means ecclesia, which means called out. And so in reality, the church isn't just a gathering place for social gatherings. The church is supposed to be a gathering place of called out ones. The Lord called you, you gave your heart to him, you've been called out of the world and into the church. Amen? Amen. And in this situation here, these are the chosen out ones. And so most Bible scholars that believe in a pre-tribulation rapture would tell you that this is not talking about the church, but instead is talking about the Jewish people who will end up, or maybe not even Jewish people, but other people that will give their heart to the Lord in the midst of the great tribulation. And so they're the called out ones. And it says, because if these days were not shortened, that's what it says, except those days would be shortened, there would be no flesh saved, but for the elect's sake, the called out ones, the chosen out ones, then those days will be shortened. Now, a person who believes in a mid-tribulation rapture and believes that you'll go through some tribulation would say, no, that's not talking about Jewish people right there. That's talking about believers. Believers that got, because the rapture hadn't happened yet, and you're having to go through some of that. And so God is shortening the time frame. I'm just telling you what they would say. God is shortening the time frame for the elect's sake. All right? And then he goes on to say, verse 23. Then if any man say unto you, lo, here's Christ, or there, believe it not. What did we talk about whenever we said that? When we said that first seal, when it's opened up and that rider comes on that white horse? Remember, I had that first picture. If you weren't here, you didn't see it. He had skulls all over the place. I said, man, that's a bad picture. I got rid of that one and I made him look pretty. Because really and truly, the people are going to want this dude. Because there's already going to be chaos and they're going to say, won't you fix our problem?
Exactly.
And he's going to say that he's the Christ. And Jesus is warning them right here. He said, whenever many will say unto you, lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it not. For there shall arise false Christ. There's been, and once again, we can be going back in time because there's been false Christ throughout time. So this chapter seems to be moving back and forth chronologically. For there shall be false Christ, false prophets. Behold, I have told you before, verse 25. Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in the desert. Let's go on to where it says right here, verse 27. For as the lightning comes out of the east and shines even unto the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. And so it's going to happen like lightning flashing in the midst of the sky. And some people would still question, and once again, I think it's a good question, is this talking about the rapture? Is this talking about the second coming? We know that the rapture, the scripture says, is going to happen like in the twinkling of an eye. And this is talking about the flash of lightning. For wherever the carcass is, there will be eagles. There will the eagles be gathered together. Now, I don't really have time to turn to it, but in Revelation 19:14, it talks about the fact that Jesus is coming back. That's talking about the second coming in Revelation 19. He's on a white horse. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And the scripture says that in that passage of scripture, that as he's coming back, they're inviting the fowl of the earth to come to eat the flesh of kings. Because all of these nations and kings and kingdoms that have come against the Lord and his anointed are going to be destroyed at the battle of Armageddon. And it's talking about the fowl of the earth eating the flesh of these kings. Now, this is what I wanted you to see right here. In Matthew 24, verse 29, it says, immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened and the moon not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. So this is really kind of where I wanted to bring you to. Because once again, whenever we opened up seal number 6 right here, what did it say? I think I put the slide in here again just so that we could see it. Matthew 24:29, we just read that. The moon shall not give her light. The star shall fall from heaven. The powers of the heaven shall be shaken. Revelation 6:12, when he opened the sixth seal, there was a great earthquake. The sun became black. Didn't give its light, right? I mean, yeah. Can you give me that? The sun became black as sackcloth of hair, the moon became as blood. Now, to be fair, in this passage of scripture here, it says the sun became darkened and the moon gave not her light. But I'm just trying to make a point, and I told you this last week, that whenever a horrendous earthquake can take place, or even volcanoes that throw ash in the air, they talked about it and it was documented that not only would it have completely obscured the point where you couldn't even see sunlight, it would obscure the moon, and then whenever it faded down a little bit and you were able to see through all of the debris and everything that was in the atmosphere, it would actually turn the moon red like blood. And then it talks about the fact that stars are falling from heaven. To me, that's significant that there's that much closeness in these two events that are taking place. And the reality of it is that it's saying, immediately after the tribulation of those days, then this begins to happen. And what I'm trying to say to you is this, is that in the Revelation 6:12 passage, there's no question, this is like, it may not be exactly mid-trib, but it's getting closer to the middle of the tribulation. Seal 1's been opened, seal 2's been opened, seal 3's been opened, seal 4's been opened, there's been all this death, people have been martyred, their souls are under the altar, and then all of a sudden seal 6 is opened up, and the next thing you know, we have all of these things that are happening, these supernatural phenomena that man can't accomplish. Man might be able to accomplish the first stuff, but I made the point that he can't accomplish this. The sun doesn't give its light, the moon's turning blood red, or it's not giving its light, and stars are falling from the sky. The wrath of the Lamb is here. The difference between possibly tribulation and wrath. And so once again, this isn't the position that I'm standing on, but I can see the possibility of a post-trib, meaning it started pre-wrath rapture. And there's probably a lot of people that would maybe, you know, argue me down, and that's fine. I'm just trying to point something out. And for us to be aware, amen, and then it goes on to say, and then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Now that's why a lot of people would call this a end of the tribulation sign, because this is obvious, sounds as though Jesus coming back. Revelation 1:7 says that he's coming back in the clouds, and all eyes will see him. And then it says right here, verse 31, and he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds and from one end of heaven to the other. I was reading behind Brother Swaggart, and his point to this was that all of the Jewish people that were scattered all over the world, that these angels are gathering the Jewish people back to Jerusalem. And that's one interpretation of that scripture. At the same time, I find it interesting where it says in First, I got some of this on slides, but you know, just real 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, we have an angel mentioned, yes, a trumpet mentioned, and it's talking about the people of God being brought up. And in this passage of scripture, it's talking about angels, and it's talking about gathering the elect from the four winds of the earth. It's talking about all of the elect that are all over the earth. And so could it also be representative of a rapture? All right. And then it goes on to say, now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and puts forth leaves, you know that summer is near. Now, this is interesting, and I actually started to do the math and put it on a slide. You remember whenever Jesus cursed the fig tree? Whenever he went into Jerusalem and he cursed the fig tree represented Israel. And Jesus cursed the fig tree because Israel wasn't bearing the fruit of God. And so what ends up happening, though, is that some people interpret this passage of scripture right here as this. When you see the branches tender and it starts to put forth leaves, you know that it's about to bear fruit again. And the idea is that what they would say is that in 1948, if I'm not mistaken, that's the year, 1948, Israel became a nation again. And Israel became a nation. And he goes on to say that this generation, it says in verse 34, shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. And so a generation in the Bible, I looked that up again, is basically really just talking about people that are still alive. And if you do the math, if I'm not mistaken, it comes out to like 67 years. So people that were alive in 1948, there's certainly people that are still alive now. And so one interpretation of that scripture, meaning that whenever you see the leaf, the branch being tender and the leaves starting to come back, it means it's about to bear fruit again. The fig tree that was cursed back whenever Jesus cursed it and now became a nation again in 1948, that generation will not pass until all of these things take place. If that is the true interpretation, I'm not going to die on that mountain because I'm not that smart. But what I will say is that if that's the right interpretation, we're like really close. You understand what I'm getting at? Because you get my point. All right. And so then it goes on to say, verse 33, so likewise, ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. All right. And so I wanted to just kind of go through. I made a couple of slides, and I wanted to point out, it talks about the clouds in Matthew 24, 30, 31. It talks about those angels, and it talks about the sound of a trumpet, and that they're going to gather the elect from the four winds. Now, you see the connections that I'm trying to make here, right? I know some of you falling asleep on me. Y'all hang in there. We won't be much longer. I'm going to start serving coffee in the back, maybe. Yeah. Some people wouldn't like that. But at the same time, look, you see the trumpet, and you see the gathering of the elect. You see what I'm trying to say? The clouds? I'm trying to make a reference to the fact that the the rapture of the church. Revelation 7:1, after these things, here you've got four angels standing on the four corners of the earth. We're going to go back to this passage of Scripture. And I want to show you some things that are taking place right there. But look at the comparison between Matthew 24:29 and Revelation 6:12. There's reference to the sun becoming darkened. We talked about the moon, the stars falling from heaven, these angels and these four winds. And there's a gathering of the elect in the Matthew 24 passage. And in Revelation, when you get to Revelation chapter 7, verse 9, there's a multitude now that's in heaven. And then this is 1 Thessalonians 4 that talks about the trumpet of God. Well, you know, one of the things that I wanted to see, because it says right there, it says that then shall this in Matthew 24:30, then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And then in 1 Thessalonians 4, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. Now most Bible teachers are going to tell you that in the rapture, Jesus descends, but his feet don't touch the earth, right? His foot doesn't touch the Mount of Olives. But he's descending from heaven. And it says, with the voice of an archangel and the trump of God. So we see the trumpet again. We see the angels again, or at least an angel. The dead in Christ shall rise first. And we which are alive will remain, will be caught up to meet them in the clouds. And there shall we be forever with the Lord. And so you see these connections that I'm just trying to show you that they're there. All right. Now, what I want you to see also is that after seal number six, whenever the sun becomes black, the moon becomes red, and the stars start falling from the sky, all of a sudden, there's some things as we transition to Revelation 7. You can actually turn there real quick. So after the sixth seal, which was up in Revelation 6:12, after that, it says in chapter 7, verse 1, if you have your Bibles open, and after these things, all of those things that we just talked about, the seal was opened, the wrath of the Lamb started falling, the kings of the earth, they weren't so cool anymore, they were hiding in the caves crying out that the wrath of the Lamb was, and it was a terrible day. After these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow. I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea. Now, I thought that was really interesting. That hit me a little bit later this afternoon. I didn't catch on to that. You know, whenever Adam fell, you remember what happened? God cursed the earth. You remember that? He said, "You from the sweat of your brow now you will eat." And he said, "And the earth will bring forth thorn and thistle." And what's interesting is that when Jesus died on the cross, he died to redeem humanity. But it's an interesting thing to me that Jesus has on his head a crown of thorns. The earth is cursed, and it produces thorns. Jesus bears the curse of mankind. Because see, God, when God created the earth, he gave Adam dominion over the earth. And when Adam fell, he gave his power to the liar. And Jesus comes back and he redeems mankind. And once again, he wears that crown of thorns upon his head because the earth itself is cursed. But then look at this. When judgment falls, judgment's going to fall on the earth. And God's going to allow the judgment on the earth to judge mankind. Because the judgment that happens is that these angels are waiting. They're ready to open to start blowing these trumpets. And when they start blowing these trumpets, all of a sudden wrath is really being poured out now. And that's whenever the water's turning into blood and just all types of things are happening. And so the earth is going to receive judgment, and in turn God's going to use that to judge unrepentant man because he refuses to give his life to God. Now, I definitely don't believe we're going to be here for the trumpets. Amen. I know that. Praise God. Because, you know, the Word of God says that you're not appointed unto wrath. Jesus took your wrath. Amen. And so anyway, he said, so these angels now are flying around. And that's a whole other story in and of itself. Because it actually, in one spot, it talks about the angel preaching the eternal gospel. God's never used angels to preach the gospel before. God used mankind that was born in sin, that was redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, to preach the gospel. The Bible says that angels look into this thing called salvation, is what it says. The idea is that they peer over the edge of heaven. Y'all, I've preached that message before. They're peering over the edge of heaven looking at this thing called redemption because they don't understand it. Their counterparts that bought into the lie of the enemy cannot come back. There's no redemption for fallen animals. Angels. The Word of God says that whenever Jesus, it says in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14, that He became flesh and blood so that He could become us, so that He could redeem us, that He didn't redeem the angels. It says He bypassed them. And He came to the seed of Abraham to redeem us. But in these last days, the Word of God says that God is going to use angels to preach the eternal gospel. And these angels they're flying around, and one of them's preaching the gospel, and one of them's saying, don't hurt the earth yet, because we haven't sealed them. We haven't sealed them yet. We got the seal of God. And let me tell you something. The word seal, because they're about to seal 144,000 Jews. 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes of Israel. We're not going to get into all that in detail. But they're going to be sealed. The word sealed there is the same word that's used in Ephesians 1:13. After you believe the truth, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. When you get born again, you get sealed. So whenever these Jews are sealed, it's because they're born again. Amen? They're born again, and that means the Holy Spirit has to be here, and that means that I believe these angels, this angel that's preaching the eternal gospel, and these 144,000, now that they've seen everything happen, they saw the Antichrist sign a covenant with their people and break the covenant and lift himself up in the midst of the temple and call himself God, and now they're being sealed, and they're going to preach the gospel also, and all of these things are taking place. And it says, but hurt not the seed or the trees till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And He sealed 144,000. And then it says right here in verse 9, after this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands, and cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God which sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb. So we're in Revelation 7, and we started at verse 9, and what we see is a multitude beyond, you can't count it. And there's people from every nation and every tongue. And they're standing, look where they are, they're standing before the throne and before the Lamb. And they're also clothed in white robes, so that means they're born again. And they're crying with this loud voice to the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne, and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces and worshiped God, saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. And then in verse 13 it says, one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they? In other words, where did they come from? And I said unto him, sir, you know. And he said to me, these are they which came out of great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Now, there's a lot of different interpretations of this. To me, I'm just saying I find it interesting that we've made all these connections about the possibility of the tribulation has started, post-tribulation, pre-wrath, rapture, when we're connecting the sun becoming dark, the moon becoming blood, stars falling from the sky, and then all of a sudden, that seal is opened up, and now all of a sudden, on earth, 144,000 Jews are being sealed, amen, with the Holy Spirit to be protected, to preach for the Word of God for God, and then all of a sudden, the next scene we see in heaven, there's a great multitude. A multitude beyond that you can't even count. And they're all arrayed in white robes and they're singing unto the Lamb. Now some people will tell you that these are those that, yeah, it says they came out of great tribulation. And some people will tell you that these were those that were martyred during the tribulation. And now one of the things, somebody sent me a Perry Stone video. on, and he mentioned this in here. Now, Perry Stone's a lot smarter than I am, but I had a question. And I went back and I watched it twice because I wanted to be fair. He says that these guys right here represent all the martyrs because, I mean, it's telling you that the number is so vast that you can't count. So it's like, it's a lot of people.
Yeah.
And it seems as though to me that it would be all those that have been resurrected. That's what I'm thinking. I'm just saying it looks like it to me. In other words, all those that were in the grave. You understand? Do you understand that the word rapture literally means resurrection? Y'all get that? When we always say the word rapture, but literally it means resurrection. It's the resurrection of the dead. Those that were in the ground. Remember that 1 Thessalonians 4? With the shout of the archangel and the trump of God, the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will go to meet them in the air. It's the resurrection of the dead. It just so happens that there's some people that are still alive on earth. And the dead precede those that are still alive. And everybody's brought up to heaven. And they're given their glorified body. So I just want you to understand that the rapture and the word resurrection are really synonymous, and really the word rapture means resurrection. Amen. Those that have died in Christ and they're going to go to be with the Lord. And so what Perry Stone said was that these represent all of those that have been martyred from the beginning of say like AD 65. Paul's head was cut off in AD 65. He was in the Mamertine prison in Rome, and he got beheaded under Nero. And so from AD 65, moving forward, all the countless martyrs that have died, Perry Stone says that it's them. My question for that, though, is this. I got two questions. Number one, for the pre-tribulation rapture, if you got your Bibles, I'm about to close. I know it's getting late. Y'all just hang with me. Revelation 4:1. After this. Revelation 4:1, it says, after this. After what? After the church age. That's a pre-tribulation viewpoint. Three chapters of the church age. After this, John was caught up into heaven. And he's able to see what's in heaven. And what does he see? He sees 24 elders. Remember that? 24 elders clothed in white robes. And they have golden crowns. And pre-tribulation commentators will teach you that these 24 elders represent both Old Testament and New Testament saints. 12 tribes, 12 disciples. And so now we see 24 people clothed in white robes. And we're told that that represents the rapture of the church. But then now over here, after the sixth seal, or after the fifth seal, and we're in the interim of the sixth seal, and these things are going on in heaven, we have a multitude of people that are arrayed in white robes. And it's so many of them that you can't count it. Now, if it is the tribute, if it is all of the martyrs that died from AD 65 until the time frame of the tribulation, my question for Perry Stone, if I could talk to him, we saw him one time, didn't we, Mr. Paul and Branson? Mr. Paul wouldn't talk to him, I didn't go talk to him. But if I see him next time, I'm gonna go talk to him and I'm gonna say, hey, explain this to me. Because, see, my question is that if these are all of the martyrs, why didn't we see them in Revelation 4? Why weren't they there with the 24 elders? Because they had already died, and the rapture's already taken place from a pre-tribulational standpoint, right? The rapture's already taken place in Revelation chapter 4 after these things, after the church age. And so all of these would have been in the ground. If they represent all of the martyrs that have taken since AD 65 until the rapture, they were all in the ground. The rapture took place. They all came up out of the sky. According to 1 Corinthians 15, they received their glorified body. Why weren't they by the throne singing and giving praise to God right there? Why didn't they get in the throne and sing unto the Lamb until after the seal of chapter 6 we're seeing is opened up on the earth? I don't know. And then the next question is, for those that say that they're the rest of the tribulation saints, why aren't they under the altar? Is it because the number's been fulfilled and now they're allowed out? I don't know. But so, really and truly, that was the main point that I really wanted to make. I know that I gave you a lot of information. I have some notes. If anybody wants the notes, I can get them to you. But I wanted you to see that possibility of a post-trib pre-wrath concept.